this is what your kids can aspire to be one day, because we've got the infrastructure, you know. So that with having MotoGP, it totally changes their perception that this is no longer a dream. By all means, Formula One is still a dream for a lot of people, you know, but for MotoGP, this is no longer a dream. This is achievable. You work hard, you know, be disciplined, focused, you can one day ride on these machines.
Hello and welcome to Last on the Brakes, the MotoGP podcast with me, From Wild, joined as ever by Matt Dunn. And this week, as you just heard at the top of the show, we'll be talking to Petronas Sepang Racing Team boss Razlan Razali. There he was talking about how you can make MotoGP an achievable dream for kids in Malaysia. But, well, Matt, hello, how are you? I noticed you've put in your notes to ask you that. So how are you? And what are we talking to Razlan about today?
I'm very well, thank you, Fran. No, I just thought we'd get a little bit more chatty these days. But, today we're talking about mainly how to build a MotoGP team from scratch and what the real meaning is and what it actually means to be in the right place at the right time, because I think there's a truly fascinating story behind that one with Razlan. We want to also know why MotoGP is so popular in Southeast Asia and how you can make a national sporting hero, which some pretty deep topics, but I think there's not really a better man to ask about it than Razlan himself. But quick disclaimer, if you're coming here to find out what Valentino Rossi's plans are for 2021, well, this is not the podcast for you. But whilst it's not a topic of conversation that we delve into at length, if you wait for the Kenwood quickfire right at the end, Razlan does give something away which gives you a very good indication of what kind of news we could be receiving very soon. I'll leave the rest up to you guys. But before we get going, Fran, a little bit more context on Razlan, because, of course, he does give his backstory in the podcast. We do. That is very important to understand where he's come from and his background. But just before we get going, Sepang Racing Team boss. But also,
exactly. Before we dive in then, you'll find out much more on the detail of how Razlan rose to be the king of such a MotoGP empire. So before he was just the team principal of the Petronas Sepang Racing Team, as he is now, earlier in the year, he left his position as also CEO of Sepang International Circuit, obviously the track just outside Kuala Lumpur. And he's been there since 2008. I think he says it was like 2 weeks before the Malaysian Grand Prix in 2008 that he jumped into there. I think it's a... it's a pretty interesting person to talk to, most definitely. All about how he got that job and how then now the enormous popularity of the sport has been grown, both from the circuit's efforts and the teams and everything else. I think it's good.
Yeah, but before we do, question of the week for you guys, a little bit more deeper this week than I guess we normally used to, because towards the end we talk a lot about winning and the accolades that come from it and how the attitudes are changing between riders of certain ages. So our question for you guys out there is your motivation for success the accolades that come with that, or are they the achievements themselves? Well, big deeper question, but I think it's quite valid given the topics. Leave your answers on Twitter using the hashtag MotoGP Podcast or in the comments below if you're watching on YouTube. Let us know. And before we get going, if you like the podcast, because you know there have been quite a few more listeners in recent weeks, leave us a review, will you, in a 5-star rating or 4-star, you know, just, you know, be nice. And also recommend it to a friend. That would be greatly appreciated. So without further ado, I guess we should get going chatting to Razlan.
Let's go.
So Razlan, welcome. Nice of you to join us from your man cave with your 100 million bikes in the background there. Firstly, just want to ask, how are you? And how's the situation there in Malaysia with all that's been going on?
Well, I'm fine. The family's fine. I think there's some positive in being in a lockdown per se for the last 2 months. But at the same time, I think it's a tad too long. I know we are all practicing social distancing, but I think the next phase would be wife and husband distancing, I think. It would be healthy for everybody. But other than that, yeah, we're all good here. Situation in Malaysia is getting better by the day. Everything is a bit more relaxed, a bit more eased in terms of restrictions. Of course, the government is promoting again social distancing, hygiene, etc., but everything seems to be great. So we look forward to go racing next month, but we know it's going to be a big obstacle to go past with all the travel restrictions, testing and all that. But still, you know, we can't wait to go racing.
Yeah, I think everyone feels like that now, don't they? And like you said, it's quite an interesting experience getting locked in with your nearest and dearest, as much as we love them. Yeah. But so we obviously want to talk to you about sort of Malaysia and the incredible successes that you're starting to see, talent promotion, everything that you've been so instrumental in building. But we also want to get to know you a little better. So we thought we'd ask, you became CEO of Sepang, which is what you recently left to take over in the team full time, in 2008, right?
Yes.
How did life kind of lead you there? Was it from sport or was it from sort of managerial side?
I think it's a combination of everything. I was appointed in 2008, which is exactly 2 weeks before the Malaysian Grand Prix. And my first my first press conference I can recall was at Sepang Circuit talking about Malaysian Grand Prix. And the media was asking me about my commitment to Malaysian talent. And on the spot, I made a commitment that in 2009, we will put a wild card in the Malaysian Grand Prix, and we did it. But just to backtrack a little bit, I'm an accountant in terms of background, in terms of my studies. I've gone through quite a number of industries, from construction to IT to event management. I think event management is something that in some ways got me to where I was in Sepang Circuit, because I was I provided artists for the Formula One Malaysian Grand Prix, all the A-list artists, and at the same time I promoted international concerts, so we brought in huge acts to Malaysia. And my interest in motorsports, I used to race both bikes and cars. I go to Sepang a lot. Sepang is like my second home then. I heard about the vacancy as a general manager then. And I applied for it. And it took 2 years for them to confirm me.
2 years? Oh, why was that?
2 years. I mean, at that time, Sepang Circuit was owned by Malaysia Airports, you know, Kuala Lumpur International Airport.
Okay.
And they went through some restructuring, so the focus is not at Sepang Circuit. But finally, it took 2 years from my interview with the chairman and the managing director of the airport, 2 years before they finally appointed me. And I think a combination of my background, my experience in event management, and of course my passion to motorsports got me to where I was in Sepang.
So can you tell us a little bit more about that passion for motorsports? Because that's a very illustrious sort of business background in all sorts of aspects. To then go so left field to motorsport is quite a change, is it not? Or were you just completely prepared for it and it was quite seamless getting into that?
You know what? Every male species has a motorsport DNA in them. Either they are.
Some of us do too.
I know. But majority are in men anyway. So sometimes it's out there glaring, or sometimes it takes a little bit of push to get the DNA out. I'm a late bloomer, actually, when it comes to motorsport. I think primarily because my parents were against it. You know, they were very protective of me and my brother, my sister, even riding bicycles and all that. So we had to sneak out and ride our friends' bikes. Or only when I was in Australia studying, I learned how to ride a bike in a farm and all that, drive a car in a farm, a friend's farm. And only until I got married, when I was independent, I bought my own bike. And from one bike become 10 bikes. And that's when I got into racing. So that's where, you know, the passion for motorsports for me surfaces. And we went to Batu Tiga, Shah Alam before, when we were the first track then. And then, of course, Sepang came in 1998. Yeah, and Formula One came, and of course MotoGP, and it all spiraled from there.
That's pretty, I like that. It's kind of like you get so often when it's like, well, then I left home and I could just do what I want. And finally it's like, yeah, this is what I like. Sorry.
Yeah, but the thing is, I had to get married to be able to do all this.
this is a little extra pressure.
Yeah, that's right.
So you said at the time then that Sepang was owned by the airport. But since it's become kind of its own centre of kind of cultural stuff, obviously based around motorsport, with a lot of kind of, not influence isn't the right word, but it's a very important place now for Malaysian motorsport. It's really grown into it. Do you think that it's helped with like your involvement and the government backing to really take it to be such a central thing now?
Well, in 2009, we evolved into a subsidiary that's owned by the airport to a subsidiary that's owned by the Ministry of Finance. So in 2009, we're basically owned by the government. It's very unusual for a government to own assets like Sepang Circuit, a racing facility.
In Europe especially,
it's
all like private people doing the counting in the background.
Yeah, so it's very unusual, and we became non-strategic asset for the country, but we were the top three recipient of government grant, okay, purely because of the rights fees that we pay Formula One and MotoGP. So we are non-strategic asset, but we are recipient, a top three recipient of government grant because of the events. So in that sense, SIC is iconic for Malaysia because of the events, but Sepang Circuit was less so. So we had to bring the image up of Sepang Circuit to a higher level so that it's nearly on par to what Formula One as a brand and MotoGP as well. So we had to do a lot of redevelopment, rehabilitation of the track and change a lot of things to make Sepang Circuit more commercial, you know, before. It was it was not managed properly. It's a free for all. Everybody can use the track as and when they like, and there's no emphasis of sustainability, you know, except for during Formula One and MotoGP. So what happens in between is important. So what we have done that for the last 11 years, we positioned Sepang Circuit as a multifaceted venue, not only for motorsport but other non-motorsports events as well. Self-sustainable, added a lot of new facilities, as you have seen in the last 5-6 years, new paddock, new south paddock, new facilities, and et cetera, et cetera. So it's something. So then SIC became a real symbol of Asian motorsports, we're proud to have Sepang Circuit as an icon. Not only for F1 and MotoGP, but as a facility as well.
That's really cool. The images of that you get from Sepang, it's sort of unmistakable with the grandstand, you know, the sort of the coverings that you have there, and then the palm trees, riders racing around that. So that's the back context of Sepang Circuit and how that's come to sort of the forefront of motorsport in Asia, as you say. But so one of the main topics we really wanted to discuss with you is the rise of popularity in conjunction with that. Of motorcycle racing in Southeast Asia, because I'm sure everybody listening, whether they just listen to the podcast and don't consume much social media from MotoGP, there's no mistaking, if you look through the comments sections on all social media platforms, it's full of Malaysian comments, Indonesian as well. I know there's some subtle differences in the language.
Yeah.
Thai, even in Indian as well. Like most of the questions I get on Instagram Live are actually a lot of Indian guys. So what we're really fascinated to discuss with you, what we're interested in talking about is the popularity of motorsport and two-wheeled motorsport in that region. Did that sort of arise in conjunction with the same timeline as Sepang becoming a real icon of motorsport? Or did it come before that and Sepang then rose to it? What's your take on it?
Well, I think it's, number one, we did not fully leverage on MotoGP. For those who have been to Malaysian Grand Prix since the Shah Alam days, I think in 1991, I think. I know there's quite a number of guys from 91 and they come to Sepang every year since. So they saw the transformation. And I can remember in 2008, Yupi came to see me when you guys came to Sepang. And he said, look, we love coming to Malaysia. It's an important market for us. We come here, we set up, we race and we leave. But you're not giving us work to do. You know, those are magic words for my ears. You know, for him to open up, for Dorna to open up. I mean, come on, man, give us something to do. Let's do this. And from that moment on, we did not turn back. You know, from 2009 onwards, 2008-9 until now, MotoGP have grown tremendously. And that's because the market is always there, because Asian countries, in terms of two wheels, the biggest number of users of two wheels is in Asia, Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam, India, or China to some respect. So we basically just complement them and really took advantage. And with MotoGP, we just have to massage it and make it look great, you know. And most importantly, it's been in Malaysia for so long. It doesn't take a nuclear scientist to figure out. Just create national heroes, you know. So that's what we did. You know, you have a huge event like MotoGP, and what Malaysians wants to see is our own Malaysians competing, whether it's wildcard or full season riders and all that. That's all it took, and we did that in 2009. As I said earlier, I committed to one World Cup, but instead we had two, okay, with Zulfami. And then in 2010, from then onwards until now, we constantly have Malaysians in on the grid. And that helps our Malaysian market. It also pushes other countries like Thailand to put in their riders. And Thailand came up. You know, in the beginning, we were the front runners for Asian Southeast Asian countries to put riders in the World Championship. Now you see Thailand is doing quite aggressively. You have Indonesia as well. Of course, the Japanese felt insecure, so they put more Japanese kids in there. So which is great, you know. So I think we developed something fantastic for the region, but we can do all that. But the most important thing, I believe, is MotoGP. MotoGP, Dorna have not changed anything so drastic to the sport, unlike the sister or the brother of four wheels. You know, I will not go there. You know, but MotoGP have not really changed. It has been exciting from the longest of time that I've been supporting MotoGP. I was a big fan of Formula One. But over the years, it just gets too boring. It just gets too sophisticated, inaccessible, and it's purely boring. It's not exciting anymore. But MotoGP remains as such. It's exciting. It's great. It has three classes. And we just piggyback on MotoGP, build it up for Malaysia, and the result is Southeast Asian is just huge when it comes to MotoGP. That's it.
Simple, I believe. it always interests me because you see, like in the UK, F1 is definitely a bigger sport than MotoGP. No one get offended. That's just the numbers and the stats. It's a reality we have to deal with. And it's kind of like there's not that much culture of motorcycling outside of the people who are bikers. It's kind of still a countercultural thing. And then in Spain and Italy and the places where it's really big, you see so many people who use a bike every day just to go to work, not because they want to own a bike. And that seems quite similar in a lot of Asian countries. Whereas F1, though, it's interesting because there's so much less in common between a Formula One car and a road car. It's like, it's just not the same at all. Like, imagine just lying back in your road car. It's just... you know, you're never going to feel like Mark Marquez when you go around a corner, are you? So, but yeah, that's interesting then, that it's more just complementing that and building it up.
But when you say that, I mean, you look at MotoGP and World Superbike, you know, people can relate with World Superbike because the machine that's used is as close as the road bike, where the GP bike is still prototype. But why is it that MotoGP is so much popular than World Superbike?
That's another interesting topic. So something I wanted to just quickly ask you about before we move on too much. You mentioned there about Malaysians wanting a national hero, and it made me think about when we talk about the situation of motorcycle racing as a sport in the US. And if you ask lots of people over there about how to make MotoGP more popular there, they say you need a hero. That's it. But MotoGP is so unbelievably popular already in these Southeast Asian countries without having, okay, you've had Hafish at the top of the sport for the last couple of years and you've got your team now. But before that, it was still just as popular. What is the difference there, do you think, in the attitude towards that sport? Why it's so popular regardless of a hero in the first place anyways?
Well, you're right. I mean, before Hafiz, Zulfami and the likes of Khairul Rampawi, we had a couple of wildcards in Shah Alam days. We had Sharul Yuzi was the last full-time rider with the Petronas team then. I think before there was no real focus to promote Malaysian Grand Prix. I think in Sepang Circuit then, prior to my arrival, the focus was just Formula One. You know, Formula One is seen to be the more glamorous, the more money making or opportunity, whatever that is with Formula One. Where MotoGP is like a stepbrother or stepchild of the event that we are just hosting it, you know. So when I came in, the mandate that was given to me is that we need to equalize both events. You know, we can't just focus on Formula One and not do anything with MotoGP. We must. So if F1 is up there, so I have to bring up MotoGP to the same level of interest and reception to the Malaysian masses as a priority. What we've discovered is that, you know, MotoGP Malaysia became a monster. and Formula One took a real back seat, came to the point where we decide, shit, Formula One is not feasible anymore, and we had to give it up. And now the Blue Ribbon event is MotoGP. It is the longest international event in Malaysia since 1991, and now becomes the biggest international event in Malaysia and probably in Southeast Asia now with the Buriram Grand Prix. It's huge.
Okay, that makes me feel a little bit better if it's the biggest international event, because me and Matt had a very interesting experience at Sepang last year. Where we had a flat tire.
Oh my goodness.
That delayed us leaving the hotel. And then we got stuck in the there's a 10 kilometer almost detour. If you when the road straight to the circuit is open, and
you have to go to the second terminal at the airport, don't you? Because you go
back around.
Yeah, that we leave from the hotel, and you normally just get to a roundabout, and you take the third exit going round, and then you're on the road down to the circuit. No problem. It's about 4 kilometres. I remember looking at the map.
Yes,
at that time in the morning, because we thought we could leave because it's later on, wasn't it? Because of the rain that was scheduled. That's why it was later
that was
on.
2 years ago.
Maybe it was 2 years ago.
Yes,
then.
It was 2 years ago. Yeah. So. So we were left a little bit later anyway, so it wasn't by much, it would have been fine, but our car had a flat tyre, so we got it changed, and then, by the time we got round, they closed off the roundabout, said you have to go all the way to the second terminal, so as Fran said, 10 kilometre detour, and just in case...
Did your car didn't work?
No, it did not.
For the sake of
the Malaysian authorities, who probably can't say how we managed to get to the circuit on time again, but we made it just enough time that I could get on the grid for Moto3 to take the images for social media. That's how long it took us to get there, and it was, oh my goodness! Yeah, I mean, you sweat a lot in Malaysia, but I was dripping. As your point, Fran. Sorry, then like the it was insane. I've never seen a traffic jam like it to get in.
We gauge the success of any international event based on the traffic jam.
I like it. Well, you then know, it genuinely is the biggest international event in Malaysia. Then that was crazy.
It's crazy. It's something that we were asked to improve every year, but it's just impossible when you have 100,000 coming in.
Exactly. It always makes me laugh when people complain about this. Sometimes things go wrong and like we had an extra thing and then got stuck. But some people just expect to get out of their seat and then go home. And it's like, guys, there's like 99,999 people who all want to do the same thing. It's going to take some time.
And it's only once a year.
Exactly. Yeah, come on, put in the time. But we'll move away from Sepang the circuit then. Obviously now Sepang Racing Team is your dominion, and it's kind of incredible watching it grow, because now you have obviously talent promotion and you have teams in the CV, you have Moto3, Moto2, MotoGP. The only thing that was kind of comparable was KTM once they joined MotoGP. But now, obviously, in Moto2, there's no chassis per se. So you have this incredible, unique structure now. How did that come from? You said you started with the idea for a wild card with Farmy and then did a couple of those. Was it like this master plan? Did you see this in your head when you started, or is it just kind of how it's evolved?
In my dreams, yeah.
Did you dare to tell anyone about those dreams, though?
the ambition and more of a dream is to one day have a MotoGP team, of course. But for most people, it's just a dream. Our intention is to start from Moto3, to develop program. To begin with Moto3, you know, so we went to CV, to the Asian Talent Cup and all that to start off Moto3 and grow with our rider to go to Moto2, grow with them and then to go to MotoGP. That was the plan, more or less. But situation came to a point where Hafiz Sharin, who was in a previous team in Moto2, so he had a fallout with the team, so we had to take him over because he is an interest for Malaysia, for Malaysian Grand Prix. So we had to take it over. So that fast-tracked our Moto2 entry for Hafiz. And before he even spinned the wheel on a Moto2 bike, we had an offer for him to go into Tech 3 for a last-minute entry for MotoGP. So that is something that we never thought as well. For the plan was to put a Malaysian boy, which is Hafiz, in 2021. Okay, so that became fast-track even. And we compromised with our performance in Moto2 because we had Fami, and then Fami didn't do too well. He retired, and we had Thule, I think. So it didn't end up very good, but doesn't matter because the intention is to put Malaysian in the MotoGP category, and we did that. And we thought, okay, we are happy with that, a Malaysian in MotoGP. And one day in Jerez, I think, we heard a rumor of a team that's in trouble in MotoGP. And I was sitting down with Johan Stigelfeld and said, you know what, if this is true, let's convince Petronas to come in and set up a MotoGP team, because that's what they want to do, because they were going around trying to sponsor teams, and believe it or not, nobody wanted them because they already had an existing sponsors and whatnot, and the earliest that they could come in was in 2021. So I thought, okay. And while we were talking about that, I saw Carlos walking in front of me, and I quickly ran to him and told Carlos, I heard about this thing. You know, is there a way that we could do something with us, with Petronas? You know, Tech 3 is going to KTM and blah, blah, blah. And he said, okay, let me discuss with Carmelo. And 5 minutes later, Carmelo called me and said, let's talk. And we talk, and Carmelo is fully supportive. And that's it, you know. If I'm not mistaken, after the race in Jerez, I transited somewhere, and Lynn Yarbrough was on the same flight.
Okay, written in and the stars.
And while we were walking towards our connection flight, I had a chat with him. Okay, and that also began the first discussion about setting up our own team. And that's it. It's just like being at the right place at the right time, seizing the opportunity, work hard to make sure it works, and we did it.
That's brilliant.
In
less than 4 months, I think.
That's something that I feel like people forget, because everyone's like, oh, you just got to be in the right place at the right time. But it's like, no, you've also got to do the right thing when that opportunity appears, right? It sounds like you just went, okay, right, let's go. And then a MotoGP team is born.
Yeah, and I think at that time it's also important to prove yourself, because I think besides at that time when we were in Moto 3 for a couple of years and Moto 2, and the relationship that we had with Dorna, with Malaysian Grand Prix, it gives them that confidence that we are competent and able to do it. You know, there are situations where, you know, some people have the luck of the world to do what they want, but without the track record, without the competency, the professionalism, it's difficult for them to convince people. You know, so we are able to do that, and we follow the same philosophy for Moto 3. It's presentation comes first, professionalism comes second, and performance is last. You know, so that was the focus. But of course, again, you know, we set up this beautiful team, and we got lucky again with Fabio. So.
there's something I want to ask you on that then, because I mean, I don't want to get into too much about Fabio. Of course, we all know how extraordinary he is, but I'm sure you've answered that sort of question a million times. But the thing that I've been thinking about hearing you talk about all that process is, it's all very well having the seamless transition all the way from the Junior World Championship all the way to MotoGP if there is a rider talented enough. But have you really grasped yet, from your own experience, how difficult it is for a rider? Can you talk to us a little bit about that? Because I suppose people might think, well, if you're in that team from the Junior World Championship, it's going to be easy, but it's not, right? So
no.
What, in your experience, can you tell us a little bit more about that, please?
If we were to remain with just Moto 3 and Moto 2, then yes, you know, I mean, the transition from the Junior World Championship to Moto 3 and Moto 2, it's there. But when you are entering to MotoGP, it's more of a business, you know. With Petronas coming in and invested a lot in us as a title partner, it became a business. It became performance is one of the top three objectives. Of course, for Petronas, it's more of the commercial part, the branding and all that. And it's important for us to have the right riders. It's not necessarily comes from the ranks, but the focus is still there. Our philosophy is still try to develop riders from the Junior World Championship all the way up. It's not going to be easy. It will take a long, long time. But because of MotoGP, because of it being a business and more prominent category, we need to put the best riders that we feel that can meet the objective of our title partner.
Interesting. You
know, so it's not like you are in a junior world championship and you have every right to promote yourself all the way to MotoGP. If you perform, yes, by all means. You know, if you're a champion in a Junior World Championship, you come into the Moto 3 and within 2 years you are a champion and you go to Moto 2, just like Marc Marquez, you know, then for sure. But again, if you look at Fabio as an example, he was nowhere really in Moto 2 in 2018. You know, there are other riders that we could have chosen because they are up there, you know, but we brought the guy in and he's just special and boom, he did it, you know. But can we find someone the same? We don't know. We just got lucky, you know. But it's not a given right that if you are from the Junior World Championship, you have the right to go all the way up. You have to perform regardless.
Okay, that's interesting as well, because I think I spoke to you a couple of years ago at the CEV as well about these kind of things. One of the things I most remember from that is you were talking about how for you it's also important that riders feel like they are in a secure environment. And it sounds like with what you were saying outside of MotoGP, obviously, where you have more pressures from different parties, that it's not just about you have to get this result this weekend or you need to go home. It's much more about that kind of development and giving riders that support, which seems to be pretty successful because we see, I don't know, it seems quite a stressful time to be a young rider at the moment, trying to make yourself through, and you have like 2 weekends to do it and prove you are Marc Marquez, or you lose the opportunity.
Yeah, well, not forgetting that, you know, we started our development program probably 10 years or so, you know, compared to Red Bull Rookies, who's been around for so long. And before Red Bull Rookies, that movie star, talent search and whatnot, you know, they've been around for such a much more longer development time. And the thing is, of course, Europeans, they are much more exposed when it comes to motorsport compared to Asia. And we always at a disadvantage because the young ones started wrong in a different kind of bikes. Anyway, we don't have as many tracks as in Europe, so it's always difficult. And the moment that we put them in a junior world championship, they're already at a disadvantage. So it's always harder for them, but it's not impossible at the same time. So we try to provide them with the best support that we can. And that's the only thing that we can do because the rest is up to them. It's not us that is riding the bike, it's them, you know. So in the beginning, we talk about Junior World Championship or Asia Talent Cup for that matter, to the Junior World Championship, to Moto 3, yes, okay, Moto 2, but now it's MotoGP. So what I did was last year, if I'm not mistaken, when we launched the Mini GPs Championship, for 7 to 10 years old, if I'm not mistaken, we did a demo thing in during the Malaysian Grand Prix on a Friday. I think
adorable.
Yeah.
Those tiny kids.
And yes, and we took 20 of those kids from 7 to 10 years old and their parents. We took them to the MotoGP garage, and we said that this is the ultimate. Okay. This is what your kids can aspire to be one day because we've got the infrastructure, you know. So that with having MotoGP, it totally changes their perception that this is no longer a dream. By all means, Formula One is still a dream for a lot of people, you know. But for MotoGP, this is no longer a dream. This is achievable. You work hard. You know, be disciplined, focus, you can one day ride on these machines. And to me, that's it. You know, that should be a great inspiration for them to work hard, and I hope so.
That's a really interesting story. I hope everybody listening like really took that all in, because I think that's absolutely fascinating. You've got 7 to 10 year olds, you're taking them to a garage to be like, this is what you can do. But what I want to ask you there then is what did you see in those, did you get to speak enough to those kids and their families to understand sort of what the attitude is of these young kids starting out at that age? Because I suppose in Malaysia, despite how popular it is, there won't be as many kids racing around at that sort of age compared to how many you have in Spain and Italy. So whereas in Spain and Italy it's more normal per se, what's the sort of attitude of those kids? Are they seen as more special in that sense because they're going for this achievable dream? What's your take?
The Malaysian kids, they are very lucky, okay? And hence the reason why I approach or we start this new program between 7 to 10 year olds because they are pure in the sense of what they want to be when they grow up. Okay, they are not spoiled in the sense of the monetary rewards, the popularity and whatnot, compared to the current kids between 14 to 16, whereby the national championship in some way have influence them more towards an ambition of money, fame, than the real objective of going to the world championship. you know. So I wanted kids that are pure in that sense, whereby they want to be where Valentino Rossi is, they want to be Fabio Quartararo, you know. So the burning desire is to be a champion, to be in MotoGP, where they're not talking about money, they're not talking about rewards, they're not talking about sponsors, you know. So that's why the plan is to start when they're young, okay, to identify the three or four guys that we feel have the potential and to take them on board and develop them as much as we can when they're young, okay, so that there's always that burning desire to win at all costs, to be focused, to be where they want to be in the world championship, and not worry about how much you're going to pay me. You know, once I get the money, I want to buy a BMW or this, that. Yeah. And that's the problem that we have right now, is the motivation of the kids between 14 to 16, 17 year olds are all wrong. You know, they're that's much really more driven than the monetary materials or anything else. And Malaysian kids are lucky because we provide the infrastructure for them from the mini GP all the way to the Junior World Championship, and we have the infrastructure for Moto 3 all the way to MotoGP, and we pay for everything.
Wow.
Okay. All right. Now, I tell you, if we open this up to the rest of the world, okay, millions of people will want to participate in this purely because of ability, the potential or opportunity to be in this system, to be where to grow into the system, whereby Malaysian kids, unfortunately, at a certain age, they're looking of, okay, I want to be in here, but how much salary do I get every month? You know, so that is a problem.
It sounds, you know, like it sounds like you're trying to instill that attitude in them of focus on the winning and the accolades come with that, rather than try and get the accolades as well as the winning.
Exactly. Correct. Yeah. So that's why for us, the mission is to start when they're young. You know, we want to identify talent as early as possible, as early as it's legally possible. You know, that between 7 to 13 years old on a mini GP bikes, identify them and work with the parents. And, you know, it's a long term, at least 10 year program all the way up to MotoGP.
That's interesting, because I always think as well, when if some rider signs a contract in MotoGP for some huge amount of money, and a lot of people will be like, oh, well, he's just taking the money, oh, well, this. I think sometimes I would say it's not even possible almost to ride in MotoGP at that level and be a top rider if that's truly your main motivation. You have to love the sport and want to win, I would argue, much more than you want whatever money you're offered somewhere.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
it's kind of true all the way up.
So sometimes we are a victim of our own success as well. I think we spoil the kids by providing too much, you know, but not forgetting, at the same time, the demographics of kids who are struggling to go into motorsport, even for two wheels, is basically the same everywhere. You know, in the past, we had this self-pity that, Malaysian boys, you know, young boys, their parents got no money, blah, 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 this and that. But when we have our European riders, if you hear the stories of Fabio, Frankie, even John McPhee, they went through the same thing. The sacrifice made there by their parents to make sure they get money, to travel in the car, sleep in the car, and all that. It's the same everywhere. So I told the Malaysian parents here, look, you guys are not special. You're not the only one that is suffering. Other kids, Europeans, are the same as well. It's just the level of motivation, the level of sacrifice, the focus, the commitment is where the difference are. Yeah. You know, but the rest is the same. So you don't think that you guys are special, we are different, and that everybody's the same.
That's really interesting.
That's interesting. So like your kind of opportunities that you can offer kind of level the playing field, and then everyone is, it's just about your own motivation and sacrifice.
Exactly.
That's interesting.
Yeah, in fact, no, in fact, the Malaysian kids have it better. Like I said, you know, you cannot get this kind of program in Spain. Who is willing to pay a kid from 9 years old from a mini GP all the way up to whatever they go if they do well? You know, no one. But we have that.
Excellent. You know, that's brilliant. You know, so something that then I want to kind of, we do have a quick fire question round for you, by the way, before we finish. But before we do that, I want to just ask, it's nothing serious, don't worry. But before that, I guess something that all the listeners will be wondering about then is, do you have a kind of timeline, anticipated timeline of when you take a kid from Malaysia, you pick a kid out and they join the program? Do you have like a set timeline of what you see progression? What age can they realistically get to MotoGP? Do you have sort of overall targets for them year upon year? What's that sort of like?
Well, the benchmark for me at the moment is what we've seen with European kids. You know, the moment they get into the Moto3 World Championship, they are around 16 years old. As long as soon as they are legal, 16, I believe, or 15, they are in MotoGP. Moto3 World Championship. So I think that's the benchmark. You know, we got Fabio in the MotoGP when he was 19. Hmm. Okay, he's an exception. But
it's crazy.
so we are looking more into the age. Of course, I'm a man in a hurry because we are working very close together with Sepang Circuit, because to me, we need to ensure a continuous participation of Malaysians every year in Malaysian Grand Prix or in the World Championship, because we still feel that having Malaysians in the World Championship, especially when they race in Malaysia, will continuously help Malaysian MotoGP be successful. So I'm a man in a hurry as well. I need to make sure that the kids are good enough, and the moment they're good enough, they can come into our Moto3 and Moto2. But in a long-term development, we want kids to be in Moto3 at least 16 years old in Moto3. So that would mean by 12 to 14, 15, they should be in the CEV, either in a European Talent Cup or the Moto3 CEV.
Okay. Fascinating. That's really cool. This has been utterly fascinating. I think this title of this podcast could be something like how to build a MotoGP rider from scratch, because I think you've answered all the questions.
I hope.
I'm really fascinated by that project. I can't wait to see it bear the fruits that you want it to in the future. Should we do the Kenwood quickfire then, Fran?
Yes, so this is a segment. Don't worry. Everyone gets so worried like it's a quiz. It's not a quiz. It's just a few little shorter questions where you don't need to, you know, just little instinctual answers. So it's sponsored by our partner Kenwood, who also gave us all our walkie-talkies and MotoGP. And they're also a sponsor for the podcast now this year. So we'll start with an easy one, which we've kind of started with a lot recently. So the first one is coffee or tea?
Coffee.
Do you Good prefer choice. Running or cycling?
Okay, cycling.
Well, you could tell that from your background behind you. That just for the listeners, there are about 5 bikes behind him in this room.
Yeah.
Cycling.
What's the best moment from your time as Sepang CEO?
Zulfami, 2012, second in Malaysian Grand Prix.
So close.
And so quick as well. What's your favourite film?
Oh, jeez. John Wick, I guess. that came out of the blue. It's John Wick. I can only think John Wick. 1, 2, 3.
Okay, so what about a childhood hero or inspiration?
Oh, my God. Okay, you're going to say that this is just because we are talking to this person, okay, but it's not. Okay. It's Valentino.
There we go.
Okay, and we had a video conference with him yesterday. So when the moment you ask him, the first thing I could think of is Valentino.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, that sounds like that we've just copped there, isn't it? We were told we weren't going to ask you about Valentino, and we're not going to, but I think that's said enough. next question then. What's your favourite moment with the Sepang Racing Team so far?
our first podium, Barcelona, I think. Yeah, Barcelona last year. Nice. Oh, that was amazing.
And I guess the worst moment maybe was Jerez, right?
No. The worst moment was Malaysian Grand Prix. We were third.
Yeah.
Yeah, that brought us down to earth, heavily down to earth.
Yeah, harsh. Yeah. Well, I mean, everyone else doesn't remember that anymore. We just remember the glory. So next year it'll be fine.
Yeah. I'm still mentally scarred for that one.
Okay, the Beatles or the Rolling Stones?
Beatles.
What's a Malaysian food or drink that every first-time visitor has to try?
Nasi lemak and teh tarik.
Okay, what are they?
Nasi lemak is basically coconut rice with dishes. Oh, beautiful. You guys should try it. And teh tarik is basically condensed tea with milk.
Oh, I love that.
They pulled it. Okay, so when they serve it, there's a lot of bubbles on top.
Oh, beautiful. Sounds nice.
I want it now.
Same.
So what's the most important thing that you've learned working in MotoGP?
Trust.
Nice. You're very quick at answering these questions. This is a much quicker quickfire than we're used to. You get a week holiday anywhere in the world, and you're not allowed to your phone or access to email or to be connected to work at all. Where do you choose to go?
I'll go to the Alps and ride my bike.
Cool.
Yeah, great shout.
What about your favorite track that isn't Sepang and why?
Red Bull Ring.
Okay, so the why is just because it's amazing.
I ran there for the first time last year a couple of times, and it's just gorgeous. It's beautiful. And I had my sons with me, so we were on a scooter, we went out, and it's really, really nice. Yeah,
I got to say, 2 weeks in Austria is not a bad thing.
Not bad.
At all.
Yeah, no, I'm excited for that one.
Yeah.
Okay, so last one then. What is the best piece of advice you've ever received?
Honesty. You have to be honest. Nice. I think that is a pillar of everything. You know, as long as you're honest, be transparent, I think you should be able to do well in life.
Great. Yes.
Lovely. Nice. I think that's good advice for listeners and viewers as well.
Yeah, quite. Well, that's it. That's the Kenwood Quickfire. And that's, the end of the podcast, I suppose. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Matt and friend. It's been a pleasure.
Well, thank you again to Razlan for his time. And I hope you guys all enjoyed that slight indication of what we might see in terms of grid movements in 2021. Ooh.
Just watch. By the time that this is edited and put out, it'll be like
live.
Everyone knows.
Yeah, but then we can say at that point, like, we knew. We
you
had
recorded
indication.
It on whatever today is.
Today
I'm
is
not
Tuesday,
sure
the 16th of June. So there it is for the record. Of course, we give you what you should go and search on the interweb this week. Next week's guest is a very, very special guest as well. Quite a high-profile person to talk about a range of topics, but won't spoil it. We have to wait and see for that one. But Fran, what should be people after this be going to look up on the interweb surfy-nut now?
Well, it's a little bit less high profile than Des O'Connor this week.
Yeah,
but no, there's a couple of racing things this week. One of them is the 2012 Moto3 race at Sepang that we mentioned a couple of brief times, and that amazing finish with Farmi just missing out on that win. And the other one was it Catalunya last year?
Yes, where they got the first podium.
Exactly, where Fabio Quartararo and Sepang Racing Team, Petronas Yamaha SRT, should use the full name for the MotoGP part, got their first Premier Class podium. Pretty amazing. And also, if you want to just remember the pure heartbreak, I think for everyone who wished him all the success in the world, that moment at Jerez as well.
Yeah.
So close.
Poor fella.
But talking of Jerez, though, hopefully we'll be back there very shortly.
Well, all set at the moment. The calendar, of course, been released. So, yes, hopefully.
I thought you said Canada has been released.
Shaved down, those poor Canadians. No, the calendar is out, obviously. We're not doing a big feature on it because if you've missed it, you've been living under a rock and nobody's probably listening now anyway. So, yeah, me and Fan will be in Jerez doing more podcasts. And so, without further ado, I guess, see you next Monday.
Ciao, ciao.